Clifford Stemme, the Pop Song Professor, and welcome to my channel where we make confusing song lyrics explained. And today we're talking about Ivy by Taylor Swift because in my theory inbox, which is linked below, I received two different theories from two different people about Ivy, and apparently it's kind of a confusing song. The first one's from Karina the Hobbit. She says she's clearly falling in love and she's clearly concerned about her husband. I just think her husband is dead. And then we have this other one from It's Doctor who says, relationship with a dead person. So apparently you guys are kind of obsessed with death and are trying to see something super morbid in what seemed like a completely conventional, normal, everyday, average song about having an affair from the perspective of the person having an affair. Which honestly is not something that I expected from Taylor Swift. So let's start from the beginning and hear what Taylor herself has said about what this song could mean. When she released Evermore, she put out this giant Twitter picture that had a ton of words in it, and I'm gonna read the important stuff to you. She's listing off all of the different types of stories without like connecting them actually to the songs, but she does refer to the quote, unhappily ever after anthology of marriages gone bad that includes infidelity, ambivalent toleration, and even murder. Obviously, No Body, No Crime is the murder one, but it would seem that Ivy is the infidelity one. At least that's what everybody thought until these two new theories came on the scene. Oh, there's also a bunch of other people theorizing that this is Taylor Swift singing from the perspective of somebody who's married and wants to have an affair or is having an affair with a woman. We got theories for days, people. So let's go ahead and jump into the lyrics themselves and see what stands up. So first off, we've got in verse one, how's one to know? I'd meet you where the spirit meets the bones, in a faith-forgotten land and from the snow. Your touch brought forth an incandescent glow, tarnished but so grand. Some people are theorizing that where the spirit meets the bones has to do with a graveyard. It is actually pulled from a poem called Compassion by Miller Williams, and in it, the idea is more like the spirit meets the bones is kind of like maybe like your heart or your internal processing center where you're thinking about all of the tough things in life and have to deal with, you know, your personal struggles. And so it could be that she's saying, you know, I meet you close to the heart. Like when I met you, it was just a soulmate thing right away. Of course, they could have also literally met in a graveyard. Your touch brought forth an incandescent glow, tarnished but so grand. I mean, if she's in a relationship with somebody else, married to somebody else currently, like, where she's not happy and things aren't great, then that would make kind of sense. Like, you know, you kind of relit the light even though my love was tarnished. In the pre-chorus we hear, and the old widow goes to the stone every day, but I don't. I just sit here and wait, grieving for the living. And this is, I think, where we start to diverge from the two original theories. The old widow goes to the stone every day. So if somebody was having a relationship with a dead person, it'd be the widow going to the stone, AKA the headstone. And that's what Karina the Hobbit said. But Taylor says, but I don't. I'm not that old widow. I just sit here and wait. And when she says that she's grieving for the living, it probably is her being sad for herself, that she's stuck in a marriage that she feels no love in when she would much rather be with this other person. In the chorus we hear, oh goddamn, my pain fits in the palm of your freezing hand, taking mine, but it's been promised to another. Oh, I can't stop you putting roots in my dreamland. My house of stone, your ivy grows, and now I'm covered in you. Now, obviously, there's some like amazing plant-based imagery here, but first take a look at my pain fits in the palm of your freezing hand. And if her pain is hot and painful at all, then the meeting of the heat and the cold hand, she warms him and he cools her off. Maybe that's something, maybe not. But what really stands out is the third line where she says that her hand has been promised to another, which at the very least means engagement, but like we hear later in the song, she's actually married. So this is indeed Taylor Swift singing from the perspective of somebody whose hand is promised to somebody else. Now that doesn't necessarily mean that that other person couldn't be dead and have died and she's like kind of struggling with disentangling herself from that relationship, but it means that she has at the very least this conflict between new love and old commitment. In verse 2, we hear, I wish to know the fatal flaw that makes you long to be magnificently cursed. He's in the room, your opal eyes are all I wish to see. He wants what's only yours. And I think she's talking about her husband. Now, if her husband's dead, that would mean that this person is technically a ghost, which would go along with the magnificently cursed line, because ghosts curse people, right? But what it really sounds like to me is that the husband is also in the room, like they're at a dinner party or something, and he's like looking at her and being like, you know, I really like my wife, she's great. But the wife is like, yeah, you're never really gonna have my heart because this dude's super cool. And verse 3 gets all sneakified because we hear, clover blooms in the fields, spring breaks loose, the time is near, what would he do if he found us out? So that, again, makes it kind of sound like the husband is alive. And at this point, I've seen no evidence that Taylor herself is in love with somebody who is dead. We do have a couple of death imagery pieces, the graveyard, the stone meets soul kind of deal. But remember how she put her hand in his freezing hand? Wait, what if he's dead and cold and that's why his hand is cold? And if he's putting roots in her dream, shoot. If she's, it could be, all right, that really threw me for a loop there because there's not a ton of imagery that is directly negating the idea that the guy she's in love with is dead and she's in love with the memory of him and that she's dreaming about him and his hand is cold and all this stuff. So I will say there is a possibility that an imaginative person could listen to the song and conclude that the person that the main narrator is in love with is dead. But what we're gonna do here is adhere to a principle called Occam's Razor. And essentially it's stated as this: the simplest solution is almost always probably the best. So if you see a black and white striped horse, we don't assume that it's a horse with paint. We assume it's probably a zebra because that's the simplest possible solution. And in this case, to me, the idea of somebody being afraid that their husband is gonna burn down the house that they're in, which is what she talks about in verse 3, he's gonna burn this house to the ground, how's one to know? I mean, what, is she hanging out with the dead guy in a crypt or something and it's like his ghost? So while it's a possibility, there is more contradiction to it than there is to the idea that it's just a simple, old, everyday average affair. Now, what there seems to be no evidence against is the idea that the person Taylor's character is having an affair with is female. In fact, I mean, you could say that, just in my personal experience, women tend to seem to have colder hands. So if it's a freezing hand, maybe that's evidence. And I've done my research and talked to some LGBTQ plus folks, and it seems that they perceive and that other people sort of confirm that Taylor tends to leave some of her romantic songs like this ungendered so that anybody could listen to it and get what they want to hear out of it. So it's a distinct possibility that Taylor Swift intended this to be a song in that vein. Even if there's not necessarily any direct proof that that's what she meant, I think the fact that she did not use gendered language leaves that possibility very open. And might be proof, in fact, that she wanted to leave it open to people's interpretations. Finally, we drop all this plant, ivy, cold, warm, graveyard imagery, and we get into the bridge. So yeah, it's a fire, it's a goddamn blaze in the dark, and you started it. So yeah, it's a war, it's the goddamn fight of my life, and you started it, you started it. In which case she's trying to, like she's been doing the whole song, give a sympathetic perspective of somebody embroiled in an affair who is now, maybe not in such a good way, kind of like shoving the blame off onto somebody else and saying like, look, this is your fault and I'm just along for the ride. Except that she's not along for the ride because like she says, it's a war. It's the goddamn fight of my life, she says. And that, I think, is a good place to end this. Guys, I've also got a podcast episode about Taylor Swift fandom where I investigated Taylor Swift obsessed people and tried out the obsession for myself, and that link is in the description. If you have a theory for a song you'd like to submit, that link is in the description too. Talk to you guys later.